So as we enter into God's word, let me just pray and ask God to help us. Father, please do help us, help all of us, help me, oh God. We need your strength, we need your wisdom, we need your leading, we need your protection, we need your goodness, we need you, we need you. Every week we pray this because every week it remains to be the same truth. On our own, we're done, but with our God, wow, Lord, the things that are possible in you. So teach us this fundamental, essential series, so key, and may today be no different. Looking to you, O God, in the name of your Son, Jesus, and if you agree, you can say amen, amen. All right, so third week in our series called Because I Said So, our essential and vital series on this, listen, on the authority of God's Word, a series on the authority of God's Word. Now, I want to remind you as to why the authority of God's Word is everything to us today. Let's look at it this way. Remember in Genesis chapter 3, at the arrival of original sin with Adam and Eve, okay? When this happened, remember that original sin was initially tempted by Satan when Satan said to Adam and Eve, these were his first words, did God really say? So just think about that for a second. The first words out of the slimy serpent's mouth in Scripture were about the questioning as to the reliability, the authority, and the sufficiency of God's Word. Did God really say? Are you sure that God meant to say that? That's so telling, that's so profound as we understand the strategy of Satan as he comes against the people of God and tries to ruin the church of God. His first words in Scripture, again, attempting to downplay, to discredit, and to disillusion God's people. Listen as it relates to God's Word. Strategy found, again, in the devil's attempts. He wanted to cultivate temptation that would result in sin, listen, that would bring chaos and devastation where the world has never been the same since. That was the strategy of Satan in the beginning. That continues to be the strategy of Satan today. Has anything really changed? No. The strategy of the evil one. If he can weaken the word, then he will weaken the church. Please know that. As soon as this book starts to get doubted, then everything begins to fall from there. He knows that. So this is why he's doing what he's doing. He starts to sow the seeds again of discrediting, of disproving, of trying to do that, which he can't, tries to, but disillusioning God's people when it comes to God's word. If you weaken the word, then you begin to weaken the authority, of course, of God's word as well. And if you start to weaken the authority, man, chaos erupts and devastation is seen all throughout the church and the people who start to move away from the authority of God's word. Here's an example of this, of a statement written in a mainline denomination within our nation right now that, let's say, 100 years ago used to be as strong as we desire to be in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the Word of God. But here's their current statement on what they believe as to the authority of God's Word. They say this: authority is neither simply outside nor inside us. The Bible cannot stand alone. Our United Church tradition recognizes this fact when we affirm that the Bible is our sacred text. That sounds good, but not in the sense the Bible is actually written by God. That does not sound so good, okay? Hence, and this is so important for us right now. This isn't theory. This is what's happening right now across this land. Hence, the basis of union does not say the Bible is the Word of God, but that it contains it, okay? Okay, just pause there for a second. That is such a terrifying statement. That is such a problem. This is Satan. Did God really say? Did God really say? Or just maybe parts of it? Or just a little part? But the problem with this is that the Bible is the Word of God, but it contains it. Well, who's deciding which parts are in, which parts are not? Who are the people that now are becoming God themselves and causing God's word to serve them as opposed to the other way around, where God is the authority in his word, as so clearly stated in Scripture, and the church now is the servant of the authority to the authority of God's word? The statement continues on. It says this: In short, we now are left to discern what is the word of God today. Can you see how devastating these statements are as they drawn out to their logical conclusions? While the Bible has an undeniable central role in our efforts to discern God's will for us in our time, it is not the only authority, precisely because it is always mediated in particular times and places. This is the greatest problem with everything that's being said. You have people now, again, taking the place in the authority of God Himself and choosing to find out which parts are authoritative and which parts need to be changed over time. Who's making these decisions? Who are these people? How can this be so? You will not have a church that stands as long as statements like this are in play. And wouldn't you know it then, this domination is crumbling at every level and has no power and has no authority and has no Holy Spirit and has no true salvation, has nothing, because God leaves and He takes His lampstand and He gives it to a people who are faithful to what He has said. Regardless of the fear of man, regardless of the pressure of culture, He's looking for a people who believe that He has spoken, and they, with gentleness and love, but with boldness and passion, they will stand in the truth of God because He has written, because He has said so. But again, notice, Satan says, did God really say? It's happening all around us. This is why Love Wins, this series is so important. This is why right now, man, this is not a game. This is not theory. This is reality. This is life and death. And if we don't have the book, man, we got nothing, because the book points us to Jesus. But again, the strategy of Satan, if I can corrupt authority and I can get authority to be rejected, and it's only a few moments, it's only a few months, it's only a little bit of time where the church starts to go down. So again, that's why we're here. This is why we're in this place. Why many of you are so interested and fired up about this. Here's where we've been within this series. Week number one, a God-given authority, inerrancy. Week number two, a time-tested authority, reliability. This week, we see this, a life-changing authority, sufficiency. We're seeing this today. And then all these lead us to this right now, which is this. Please open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3, all right? Please open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3, and we'll be reading verses 14 to 17 today, all right? Bible's open, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. Paul says here, under the inspiration of God Himself, he says, but as for you, he's writing to Timothy, but as for you, continue in what you've learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. That's an important phrase. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. Why? Listen to this, verse 17. That the man of God may be complete or competent, equipped for every good work. Okay, so our context in 2 Timothy is Paul writing to Timothy, and Paul knows as he writes this that his life is nearing the end. Paul is in jail. Paul is awaiting execution for his faith in Jesus Christ, but Paul in jail has the opportunity to still write, okay? God maximizes his opportunity with Paul's life. Let me ask you this question. You know you have moments to live, or you have a season to live, and then you are going to be put to death because of your faith. You have the chance to write. Let me ask you this question. What do you write about? What do you choose to write about? The answer is, you choose to write about, especially when God's Spirit is working in you, that which is most essential and that which is most important, especially as you try to pass on truth to your young mentoree, Timothy, who God is raising up to be used in this life. And so it's no surprise then that one of the most important pieces of Scripture pertaining to the authority of Scripture is found in this section and within this context. What Paul does, he kind of grabs Timothy by the scruff of the neck, and he says, Timothy, listen up, man, listen up. I got important things to share with you right now. My life is about to end. But listen, you can be used, and you have to continue in the things that you have learned. You continue in that which you have firmly believed, that all Scripture is breathed out by God. Timothy, preach the word, which is the text coming up in 2 weeks from now. I'm so excited about it already. But Timothy says, listen, or Paul says, Timothy, listen, this is so, so important. You have a life-changing authority given to you by God. Use it as much as you can in the ways that God gets glory. Use it, O Timothy. It's been given to you by God. That's our context, and that helps us understand right away the situation of this life-changing authority given in the Word of God, which takes us to our first point, which is this. Why is God's Word a life-changing authority? Well, number one, because it's this, it's sufficient to save my life. The Bible, written by God, the ultimate purpose of the story of redemption is its sufficiency to save my life. Now listen, there's no other book in the universe that can claim such a thing. There's no other book in the universe that can prove to be such a thing. God's Word is sufficient to save my life. Look again at verse 14. But as for you, Timothy, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you've learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, the Scriptures, the Word of God, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. So notice, first of all, in verse 14, notice, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed. So the but as for you, Paul is contrasting other people he has referred to. For instance, look at verse 13. But as for you, he says in verse 13, Timothy, don't be like the evil people and the imposters. Timothy, they're going astray. They're the ones who are taking evil to a whole new level. He's like, but as for you, Timothy, continue in what you have learned in the truth and the purity of God's word. But as for you is also, though, contrasting in chapter 3, verses 1 to 5. And notice the people that Paul mentions here in God's word. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. But understand this, that in the last days, there will come times of difficulty. Why? For people, hey, by the way, always align yourselves and align your expectations with that which the Bible actually teaches, okay? So notice what the Bible is teaching us so clearly. Man, it's going to be difficult at the end. Why? Verse 2, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, obedient, or arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control. Wow. Continues, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people. See what Paul says now? But as for you, Timothy, but as for you, you continue in the Word of God. You continue by faith in that which is most essential. You know the truth, Timothy. And you must hold fast to it if you have any chance of seeing God work in your life. This really becomes a powerful exhortation for Timothy's context. And listen, it becomes a powerful exhortation for our context as well. Timothy, many evil men will surround you. But as for you, you continue in the truth. Timothy, these are dark and evil days. There's a tremendous pressure to cave in. But as for you, Timothy, continue in the end. Timothy, persecution is inevitable. Look at verse 12. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. See what Paul's doing? He's not sugarcoating this at all, man. Timothy, it's going to be tough. But as for you, see his path of endurance? Stick to the truth. Cling to the truth. Timothy, the Word of God is everything. The persecution's here and it's coming. Continue to trust in the Scriptures. So what a moment of truth for Timothy. And listen, what a moment of truth for us. You know, my question as I sat in this study of this week, I'm just like, where are the young Timothys in our day? Where are the young men and women in our day? Who are the young women and the young men who will stand up with a courageous faith in Jesus Christ and hold to the authority of Scripture? Here's what we know. Listen, every generation must decide what they believe about the Bible. We can't do it for them. And there are some young people here right now. Listen, man, I speak to you. I speak to you without hesitation and with passion and boldness, man. What are you going to stand on? and what cost are you willing to count in the pursuit of what is actually true and right and the truth that is the difference between eternal hell and eternal heaven? Who's going to be raised up? Who will take that stand in love and in gentleness, but with a passion again and a boldness? Who will be the young men and women who will continue in the faith and the truth of the scriptures of God? We pray. We need so much that God will be raising them up. And even in our midst now, maybe you're here right now and God speaks to you. And I don't care if you're 10 or 20 or whatever, that God would speak to you and say, my hand's on you, and but you must continue in what you've learned and have firmly believed. And notice verse 15, and how from childhood, Timothy, you have been acquainted with the sacred writings. Notice that, how from childhood. Let me just say this, man. Harvest Kids in this church is not a waste of time. Harvest Kids, there are young Timothys all over the place in that ministry. Hey, are you serving in Harvest Kids? Bless you. Bless you. Hey, are you considering serving in Harvest Kids? Bless you. There are few greater privileges, and you got to see it for what it is. There are few greater privileges than taking a child and pouring into them the very truth and the Word of God inspired by Him. And this is what we need to see. This is the power. This is the blessing. Here's what we know in chapter 1, verse 5 as well. We know this, that Timothy had a grandmother Lois and a mother Eunice that Paul said had a sincere faith, which now dwells in you also, is what Paul says. So notice this, Timothy's upbringing from a child, the Word of God was poured into him and teaching him the ways of Christ with a sincere faith. I love that, with grandmother and mother mentioned right there. It's so great. Any grandmas in the house today? Bless you, man. What a role you have. Any moms in the house? Of course there are. Bless you. What a role you have. And that's not discounting dads at all. But the power of from how childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, it's so essential as we understand this book, this truth that is sufficient to save our lives. But here's a question I ask as we see the emphasis on Timothy's life as the truth of God and the Word of God when he was just a child before God. Hey parents, what are we teaching our kids? In all honesty, what are we teaching our kids? Are we teaching them that life is about success in sports, in academics, in the arts? All those things are great in a lot of ways. But please understand this, okay? None of those things can save your child's life. None of them, okay? So let me be crystal clear, okay? My kids are in sports. I want my kids to do well in study in school, and there's even a little bit of the arts coming into our home. It's not coming from me. You know what I'm saying? I'm just not good at that, all right? All right? But we do, our kids do these things, but at the end of the day, okay, your child could be win the Nobel Prize, they could be the next LeBron James, they could be the greatest artist in the history of the world, but they don't have Jesus Christ, they got nothing, okay? They got nothing. There's one book and one truth that could actually save our lives, and that's why this book is so important, and the gospel of Jesus Christ. But again, I know what parents are like because I'm one of them, and I know the temptation, all our resources into these external things, all our energy, all our passion. Just again, time out long enough. What are we actually teaching our kids when the sports is more important than church? What are we teaching them? We are teaching them that sports is more important than church. Duh, right? And are we surprised then? Again, why do we? Here's one of the greatest limiting factors of children finding a sincere, fired up faith as they grow up is because they look to their parents and their parents don't have a sincere, fired up faith in Jesus Christ. Understand this, parents. You cannot teach what you don't know. And you cannot lead where you don't go. Wisdom time. Wisdom. I love when wisdom calls out. It's just like, it's like stake in the ground. Wisdom's calling out right now. What are we really teaching our kids? As they look at our lives, what message are they ultimately receiving? What's it really about? Wisdom says, man, there's only one message that can save their lives. All those other things could be great, but there's one thing that's the greatest. Where is the Word of God? Where's the Word of God in our lives? And trust me, as a dad of four children, okay? this is being preached to myself as much as anyone here in this room right now. Okay? I need the help of God to show them the reality of what's most important. You know, this past weekend, right now, our junior highs are on a retreat up north, and Pastor Carl is leading them, and bless his leadership in this regard. It's a spiritual disciplines retreat. Okay, so they're up there, and it's sold out, which is so great. I think both junior high, senior highs next weekend. Here's some pictures of what they have been doing yesterday, okay? So Carl taught on the Word of God a little bit. Then he taught, here's how to study God's Word. Here's three questions, stickers for the Bible. Go away. Here's two passages. Take these passages and answer these questions, learning how to study the Word. Some of you are like, man, I could use that right now, right? Well, I mean, it's available. Look at these pictures. They're all reading their Bibles, all these students, and here in this beautiful setting. This guy's on the top of a slide. That's creative. And then there's this people here in their cabin. And there's the Bible there. I mean, these are junior highs. Okay, let me point out this, okay? Your sports team isn't teaching this stuff. Your sports team's good. This is better. Because right now, man, who knows what this young man right here is God's Word. You never know when God's going to open up his eyes, change his life, and absolutely call him as a young Timothy, continue what you learned, what you firmly believed from the sacred writings from childhood. And who knows, it could be the next Spurgeon. But if we're not doing this, man, there's little chance. Again, your sports team's not doing this. Wisdom. Wisdom. What are we teaching them? What's the example that we're setting? God help me. No. I want to do this right now, too. I want to apply the gospel in this moment. Because there's a lot of people like myself are tempted as you feel the conviction of, man, I stink as a parent. And I'm a failure. So am I, okay? I'm a failure too. Listen, that's why Jesus gave us the gospel, okay? Because you and I on ourselves, we can't do it. So right now, if you're feeling guilty, and if right now you feel all beat up, and right now you're just like, wow, man, I got to get things together. So do I, okay? But again, that's why Jesus Christ died for all our sins, past, present, and future, because today in the gospel is another new day, all right? So you're a failure, so am I. Let's take our failure together. Let's present it to Jesus Christ. He's like, I got that. I can't do Jesus. He's like, I know. I can in you, okay? I can in you. So again, we will be so discouraged as parents if we say, I got to do this, and I got to do that, and I don't know, because we can't do it. We can't be the people and the parents that we're to be in our own strength, but we can in Christ's strength, amen? This is the point of the gospel. So you take your guilt right now and you smash it with God's word, taking that lie and throwing it out. No, embrace the conviction. I love conviction. I need conviction because conviction by God's Spirit says, Rob, you need to change. Amen, Lord. I need to change and you got to help me. He's like, I got your back, man. I will change you. You get on your face and you pray to me. You get on my word and you say you need me. You help me understand how much you're dependent upon me, Robbie. You watch my grace fill your life. You watch my strength fill your life. And you're no different. So guilt gone, conviction in, hope everywhere. All right? Apply the gospel to all these situations. You stink as a parent, so do I. Praise God, all right? We need the gospel for that. And make us the men and women we can't be in and of ourselves. Is that clear, church? Is that clear today? That's very, very important as we go forward. Man. We're not condemned. We have conviction. But we are Christ, our Savior, who fills us and strengthens us to be the people that we cannot be in and of ourselves. How from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings. Now look again at verse 15. This statement's massive. Timothy, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, what a significant statement pertaining to the doctrine of God's word that this is. Let me read it again. Which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. What do we have right here? We have the sufficiency of Scripture. What does sufficiency of Scripture mean? Here's the definition on the screen for you. It means this. Sufficiency is the truth that the Scriptures contain everything we need for the knowledge of salvation and godly living. Okay? So, when it comes to God's Word, it's not the Bible and. It's just the Bible. The sufficiency of Scripture means everything we need for the knowledge of salvation, to go to heaven with Christ, to be saved from our sins, and to live godly lives before Him, it's all in the book. If all we had was one book, we're good. Okay? You don't need, other books can be helpful as they point back to this book. At the end of the day, for salvation and righteousness in Christ, God living, this book is sufficient. Okay? The sufficiency of Scripture. We don't need any new revelation from heaven. God's not right now, I meant to say, and give us a whole new chapter. Okay? That's what cults do. Okay? No, everything is in here. Now, the necessity of Scripture, I want to make sure these two things are clear. The necessity of Scripture is that general revelation is not enough to save us. General revelation is no one is with excuse. No one can walk around this world and say there is no God, because God has supplied an infinite amount of evidence to say there's a designer who created everything. General revelation also gives us a moral compass within us. There's a reason parents would not take their child and slaughter their child before them. There's a sense of, there's a moral right and wrong given to us by God. So every person is without excuse. However, general revelation, looking at the sun or seeing the stars or seeing insects walk in the ground, is not enough to show us how to be saved from our sin in Jesus Christ. That's why we have special revelation, which is the Word of God. The Word of God is special revelation. It's the gospel. It's the story of redemption. We cannot know God savingly by means of personal experience and human reason. We need God's word to tell us how to live, who Christ is, and how to be saved. Okay? These definitions are by Kevin DeYoung. Okay? There's many definitions, and they say the same truths. Okay? So, the Bible is necessary in that the gospel must be preached in some form. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of Christ. You can't be saved apart from the gospel. Either reading it in God's word, it's preached to you. There's somehow, some form, the gospel is shared. It's necessary for salvation, but the Bible is sufficient for everything we need to know about salvation and for godly living, okay? So don't miss how profound this is then when Paul says to Timothy, continue in what you have learned. The difference between eternal hell and eternal heaven is found within the message of the gospel, found within the Bible. There's no other book in the universe that carries such power. So we've got to think about this. The Bible is sufficient, it's necessary. And we ask ourselves, well, am I reading it? Do I see how important this book is? And it's amazing how many Christians, believers, whatever, they say, well, you know, I'm too busy to read the Bible. Really? Really? Well, I'm too lazy to read the Bible. That's an honest answer for some. I'm just too lazy, you know? I'll read the Bible, but I'd rather work out, sleep in, watch TV, check email, do my makeup, check stocks, shop online, eat food, text a friend, drink coffee, play music, see a movie, read fiction, decorate my house, choose a new outfit, plan a vacation. Now, all those things might be okay, but none of those things can save your life. None of those things can come even close to saving your life. Again, wisdom calls out. All those things might be okay, but one message can save my life. Again, you can be the greatest in everything in the history of the world, but without the Scriptures, you end up having nothing. And notice our text says right there in verse 15, wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. It's the book that points us to Christ. Hear me. We don't read our Bibles to earn salvation. We read our Bibles to learn about salvation. We see this here, through faith in Christ Jesus. Through faith, not works, man, not works. The Bible, though, is sufficient. It's sufficient to save my life. So consider then the necessity and the sufficiency. Consider then the inherent authority that is found within this book. This is the one tangible gift that God has given to His church. The one tangible thing we can hold and touch and feel and read and turn the pages. It's this book. The one tangible thing God has given to us. Is it collecting dust or is it written on our hearts? Again, this is so important. This book is sufficient to save my life. This book then is also sufficient to do this. Number two, it's sufficient to transform my life. Look at now verse 16. This should be familiar if you've been here the last couple of weeks. All Scripture is, look at Paul, led by the Lord. Just look how serious he is. All Scripture is breathed out by God. And profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be complete or competent, equipped for every good work. Verse 16 circles us back to the beginning of the series as to the doctrine of inspiration, every word has been put there, more accurately, breathed out by God. And anything that has been breathed out by God is guaranteed to be perfect. And if it's perfect, listen, then it's this, verse 16, it's profitable. But what does it mean that the Bible's profitable? It means that it's supernaturally beneficial, that it's supernaturally sufficient. So look at it this way. The Bible is a one-stop shop. You know one-stop shops in our day? They claim they have everything from food to hardware and everything else in between. But the Bible is a one-stop shop. Like when you rest in the Bible, it's all that we need for life and godliness. It's all that we need for a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and a pursuit of godly living in Him. The Bible is sufficient. The Bible is a one-stop shop. Therefore, it is absolutely profitable. But how specifically is it profitable within our lives? Well, verse 16 gives four reasons. You should see them there very clearly. Let's go through them one by one. These are on the screen beside me too. The Bible is profitable because, first of all, it teaches me. It's profitable, the text says, for teaching. Now, on one level, this is immensely obvious. The Word of God is our teaching authority. I have nothing to say without the Bible. There's no content to these sermons apart from the Bible. But as we began, though, the very battle and this message is a battle ultimately for truth, right? So the Bible then teaches us to keep us on the path of where God would have us. Let me say it again. Jesus said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Do you see the word teaching there in verse 16? It can be translated also as doctrine. So hear me. Look right here. If doctrine isn't taught, the people die. The teaching of God's word is essential for the people of God to survive and be nourished in that which keeps them on the path of God. I want to show you this. I want to show you how important teaching and doctrine is within Scripture. What I'm going to do right now is just go through 1 Timothy and show you all the verses that Paul is emphasizing the word teaching or doctrine. They are synonymous in these cases. And notice how much Paul brings up the important Timothy. Continue in what you've learned. Here's the first one from 1 Timothy chapter 1. It's this. And he's speaking of the evil and then the importance of rejecting that teaching. The sexually immoral, men who practice homosexuality, enslavers, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine. Timothy, avoid. Avoid. Sound doctrine's everything. Here's the next verse. 1 Timothy 4. Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teaching of demons. Again, we shouldn't be surprised at the opposition and the temptation for confusion. The Bible promised us this was going to happen. Okay? Here's the next verse. If you put these things before the brothers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, being trained in the words of the faith and of the good doctrine, the teaching you have followed. Next verse. There's just so many. This is one letter in God's word. Until I come, devote yourself, Timothy, to public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to the teaching of Scripture. And God cares about doctrine? Yes. His teachings. Doctrine is his teachings. Next verse. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Why? Persist in this, for by doing so, you save both yourself and your hearers. See how important this is? If we waver off of sound doctrine, man, people die. It's right here. Next verse. One letter. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. Why? Because without the teaching of God's word, the church disintegrates. Next verse. 1 Timothy 6, let all who are under a yoke as bondservants regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and the teaching, we live out the teaching of God, may not be reviled. I think there's a couple more. One letter. If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, we are to avoid such people. There's the emphasis. Is there one more verse or is that it? Is there one more? No, that's it. The emphasis on doctrine and teaching is inescapable. So let me point out the obvious. That is why a series like this is both life-giving and life-changing. And we're loving. the one thing that God has given to us that has allowed the church to stay on track with all the false teaching and all the temptations of Satan and all the misuse, the one thing that has brought the church back on the path of God in the straight and narrow is the Word of God. Without this, man, there is no church. The church is sunk. Everything comes down to this book. Okay? It is what guides us and allows us to discern between good and evil, what is true and what is false. Now, wouldn't you know it, in the middle of all this study that I'm doing, in the middle of all this emphasis and passion I have for the Word of God, particularly right now, the one day that two young Mormon boys decided to show up to my door is yesterday, all right? So just imagine that, these young Mormon men, they show up, they're looking, you know, they're all put together and they're polite and all of that. And I see them walk up to the door and my first, it was like Saturday night service was getting close and I was like, oh. And I was like, no, Rob, come on, Rob, come on. And then I walk up and my wife is there, I got this. And so I opened the door and I just started to talk to them and basically in my heart and just was kind of saying to them, hey, let's talk. And I started asking some questions, you know. So what do you believe? What do you believe about Jesus Christ? Was Jesus Christ the Son of God? Was he really the Son of God? Or was he created? Do you believe that he is God himself? What's your view on the Trinity? Do you believe, it's interesting, you're talking through, and I wasn't fully brushed up on Mormonism yesterday, but I've had enough study in the past and stuff to understand some of the questions to ask. And I bet you most times they knock on the door, the people are just saying, can you please leave? Can you please leave? And I'm like, can you please stay? Can you please stay? And getting into this very interesting conversation. Hey, where are you from? Utah. Where are you from? Idaho. You're missionaries, huh? Wow. That's impressive. And one light with that too. And so let's talk about now where you get your beliefs from. What's the Book of Mormon to you? How do you know where that came from? How do you know that it's a trustworthy piece of scripture? And where what did it all that stuff? Remember, it was 1.2 to saying, do you believe that you're here right now earning your salvation by trying to witness to me? They want to tell you the things that they think that you want to hear, but in reality, you know what they're taught to believe, and it's so close, it's so far away. And at one point, I said to them, these two young men, you're here today because you think that you're sent to talk to me. I want you to know, I believe with all my heart, you're here today so I can talk to you, all right? And I was praying as they were leaving, amen, one clap, a clap, amen. Amen. And I was praying that as they left and as they walked through the neighborhood and as they put their head on their pillows last night, wherever they are, I pray that they would hear my voice ringing in their ears, you know, as to the truth and what God wants to do. I pray that would be happening. You can just take that out if you want. Are you okay? You're good. Bless you, Shelly. Bless you. Yeah. And I was praying too much. They would hear my voice in that way, and just something that God would use that, to expose to the truth. But listen, I came away from that and just like, Lord, that's the perfect thing that you gave me to understand. Without this, man, we're done. This is the difference. This book, to know what it says and to believe that God has written this and to be able to compare it and contrast it with different things and different teachings and different cults. It's imperative that we stand on the truth of God's word and where we are. It's so, so utterly critical that the word of God, what does it do, loved ones? It teaches me, it teaches us. We need to be men and women of this book. Otherwise, we stand no chance. The second thing we learn right now is that it reproves or rebukes me. It rebukes me. So think of all the times. It says right there, the word of God is profitable for teaching, for reproof. Think of all the times that God's word has played a role of rebuking you and me. It's beautiful. It hurts, but it leads us to such healing. What does God's word do? It becomes a light that shines into our lives. And listen, the word of God exposes areas of our sinfulness and draws us into the light that we might be changed, that we might be rebuked, but by the love of God. Listen, a life without biblical reproof is a life that will be lost in the dark. There are some of you here right now, you don't want to be rebuked. You don't want reproof. If you don't want reproof, you are running away from God's instrument of love in your heart and life. You can't grow in Christ without being reproved, without being rebuked. The word of God is profitable for reproof. We need reproof if we're going to grow. Again, it hurts. Reproof does hurt. But God uses that to heal. And right here in God's word, man, God uses it to teach us, to reprove us. And then thirdly, this, it uses it to correct us. Notice verse 16, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction. I love this. This is where you, if you have a soft heart, the soft heart gets taught and the soft heart gets rebuked, but the soft heart doesn't refuse rebuke. It accepts rebuke and then it finds correction for their lives. So correction here literally means in the Greek to straighten or to restore to proper original condition, okay? So I love this. God uses his word to correct us. How many of us have walked into this place messed up, all crooked and miserable? I mean, so many times I myself am like that. But you come under God's word and God teaches you. He rebukes us lovingly. He corrects us by his word. And we're put in the position we were meant to be in. And all of a sudden, we're not perfect. We're following the one who is perfect. And we sing and we have joy and we have delight. And we know that we belong to the King. And we understand the gospel. And his word has corrected us and teaches us and shows us the way to go. It's so awesome. We need the word of God to make us into the image of the Son of God. And without it, we cannot do that. Notice this chart we have on our Because I Said So resource page. Notice this chart of how God's word does correct us. This is so exciting. The Bible is like a seed that saves us. So when we're in a place of heading towards death, the seeds of the gospel, it corrects our thinking and says, no, here's the path to salvation. That's awesome. The Bible's like water that washes us. So sin covers us with filth and we're so dirty. And the word of God comes and rebukes us and corrects us and cleanses us and washes us. The Bible is like a fire that cleanses us from impurity. So we have all this impurity in our lives and the lust of the flesh. But God's word comes and again it corrects us and purifies us, cleanses us to what is right. The Bible is like a hammer that shatters us. So in and of ourselves, we're proud. We walk around, but the Bible comes and it's like a hammer and it breaks us into pieces. So beautiful. This puddle of mush before the Lord. It corrects our lives and puts us in this place of having a soft heart. The Bible is like a sword that cuts deeply into us. We learned last week the Bible is like a two-edged sword that judges the thoughts and intentions of our heart. It corrects us and shows us where we need to go. The Bible is like medicine to keep us from the sickness of sin. So sin makes us unhealthy. Sin starts to kill us. The Bible comes in and gives us the antidote. It corrects us to make us healthy. Here's the next slide. The Bible's like a mirror to reflect us. The problem with your own face is you can't see it. And so the Bible's held up as a mirror to show us, well, that's what I really look like. I need help. It corrects us as we view ourselves. The Bible's like a lamp to our feet. So by ourselves, we're in darkness. We cannot see. The Bible corrects our vision, shows the light of where we are to go. The Bible's like a counselor that comforts us. When we're fighting through despondency and despair and Satan tempts us towards these things, God's word comes in and says, no, you are a child of the living God. You are a co-heir of Jesus Christ. You are guaranteeing glory that today's a great day in the reality of the gospel. It counsels us and comforts us and corrects us in right thinking. The Bible's like a forecaster that never fails us. When we don't know where to go and we're all lost and God says, come this way through his word, corrects us. The Bible's like milk that nourishes us. So often in life, we eat spiritual junk food and we're packing ourselves and filling ourselves with just junk. And God's word comes in as milk and meat, nourishing us and satisfying us with the true feeding of what we need. And this is the role that only the word of God can play within our lives. It's so important. It corrects us. And then lastly, we see this, it trains us. The Bible trains me, verse 16, and for training in righteousness. Now, can I just say this? Thanks. In verse 16, when I read these verses, okay, and I read, continue what you've learned, sacred writings, make you wise for salvation, all scripture breathed out by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, verse 17, that the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. Can I just say this? It boggles my mind as I look across the landscape of the church. I'm just like, what's the problem? Why is this book being closed in so many settings? Has God not made himself clear? Loved ones, is this clear to you? This is really clear to me. It just, it terrifies me how many people, men and women, will stand before God in judgment, and they'll just be like, the Bible will be like hiding behind their back somewhere, I guess, because that's what they've been doing most of their lives. And God will be like, how come you didn't teach what I gave you? What are they going to say? Well, I don't think you were clear enough, God. Oh, I don't think you had enough there. What are they really going to say? Because God's just going to be like, I wrote down on paper a book that was translated into your language, and there were hundreds and thousands of copies at your disposal. And centuries proved that this book was written by me. And all scripture, why didn't you teach it? What's the problem? I don't know what they're going to say. This is what I think about, loved ones, and I hope you think about this too. At the end of the day, we answer to one. This is very clear. And we haven't even got to chapter 4 yet. The undeniable exhortation of preach the word. It boggles my mind and it breaks my heart. It breaks my heart at the amount of people who fear man more than God. Hey, would you be praying for us as a church and praying for your elders and praying for me as your pastor that we would not capitulate to the culture but have the faith and the courage and love and humility and gentleness but conviction and boldness to stand on that which we know is so clear. Because if we don't do this, loved ones, we're dead. And that's why God's blessing right now. Because he's looking for people who are faithful to him. Because the Bible is used to train us in righteousness. Training is the term of like a parent disciplining their children or rearing their children. It's a form of disciplines that are gathered. The Bible trains us towards righteousness. The Bible becomes then like our greatest personal trainer. It forms habits of healthy, godly living. This is what this book does. It trains us. We think of all the time that we train ourselves in study and athletics and hobbies. But do we allow ourselves to be trained in the righteousness found in the Word of God? And again, notice verse 17. I'm done here. That the man of God may be complete or competent, equipped for every good work. You see that? The Word of God is used to bring us to maturity. If you close this book, loved ones, you don't stand a chance. Ready? Look right here. Look right here. Ready? 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 Maturity, immaturity. Okay? Completeness, incomplete. Ready? Ready? Competency, no competency. Okay? God at work in my life, no God at work in my life. God working through my church, no God working through in my church. Okay? It's not complicated. God has written this book. And then the last truth, I want you to hear this. Why does God say, listen, the word of God, it is used for teaching, for rebuke, for correction, and for training. The ultimate reason he brings us his word is to bring him to us and to bring us back to himself. The motivation of God through his word is what is love. Love. The reason we're in God's word is because he wants to love us. When we stray from this book, we stray from his love. No matter what you hear out there, man, if God is love, then God is this. No. God wrote the book on love. God defines what love is like. And he keeps us here at the end of the day. This is the safest place we could ever be. It's in his love. That's why we have these commands. And his commands, again, they are not burdensome, not at all. His motivation is for our best provision and blessing resulting in his greatest glory. Loved ones, he wrote a book, man. He wrote a book. And we're called to read it, to love him, to know his glory. God help us. Amen? God help us. Let's pray. Father, I think you're building some foundations right now. And I pray you are. God, I pray you are. Oh, I pray there's young people here right now from childhood. You've acquainted them with the sacred writings. Oh, God, I pray there's such a strengthening. I pray there's such a resolve. I pray there's such an eye-opening time right now of what you and you alone can do. Loved ones, think about it. Did God really say? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He did say. Because he said, so what? He wrote a book, why? To save our life. Awesome. And to transform our life. And his only motivation in this is love for his glory. Wow. Wow. Yeah, he said so. And I pray right now we would know so. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Change us and transform us. We need you and love you. Jesus' name, amen.